Good morning. Thank you for logging on and tuning in today. As you know, we've had to cancel our services today because of the coronavirus. It's the first time since May that we've actually had to do that. We've been really blessed as a church this year. Up until this past week, we only had about 6 cases in the whole church for the whole year. And now we've got more than that just in the past week. And so the elders decided the best thing to do was to cancel everything today. My wife Melissa's sick and I'm having to quarantine, so I couldn't have been here to preach in person anyway. But we'll see how things go this week, and we'll make a decision about next Sunday as we get a little bit closer. We're still hopeful we can meet next Sunday, and possibly we can hopefully meet on Christmas Eve as well. But we understand that some of you will be staying home for a while, and that's okay. We support you in whatever you need to do in order to be safe and healthy during this time. But at the church here, we're going to be redoubling our efforts to keep everyone safe and healthy when they're on this campus. We're going to be continuing to make sure that everything is cleaned and disinfected in a proper way. We're also going to be enforcing social distancing and the wearing of masks to a greater degree, and you'll be getting more information about that in the next week or so, in the near future. But in the meantime, I just want to say thank you for all the prayers and all the phone calls, checking on me and Melissa. Melissa seems to be doing well. She seems to have a mild case right now, which is a good thing. Hopefully that will continue, but we really appreciate your care and concern. And we just want to say thank you for that, and I want you to keep praying for everyone who's sick. Keep praying for those who have the virus. Keep praying for those who have other concerns and issues as well. We know other people in the church are having other problems as well, so keep praying for them. And let's just keep being the body of Christ. Let's keep checking on one another. Let's keep caring for one another. Let's keep bearing one another's burdens. Let's love one another as Christ has loved us. Amen. Today is the third Sunday of Advent. Advent is the name given to this season of anticipation and celebration, because during Advent we celebrate the birth of Christ and His first coming, or His first advent. We also anticipate or we wait for the second coming or the second advent of Christ. And today we look back to an event that took place 2,000 years ago. And the people of Israel were living in exile then. They were looking back on how God had delivered them in the past, and they were crying out for Him to come and to deliver them again by sending their Messiah. And the church is in the same boat. You know, we're living in exile today too, aren't we? This is not our home, the Bible says. And so like Israel, we look back on how God has helped us in the past. And we cry out for Him to come and deliver us again. We cry out for Christ to return as He's promised to do. We cry out for Him to come and to bring peace and justice and righteousness to the earth. And one of the ways that we celebrate Advent is with a wreath that's symbolic of the season. And there are 5 candles in the wreath. 3 of the candles are purple, which is the color of royalty. And the candle we light today is the candle of joy, and it's pink or rose-colored in honor of Christ, who is also known as the Rose of Sharon. And then in the center of the wreath is the white Christ candle, which symbolizes Christ's holiness and His purity, and it reminds us that He is the light of the world. And every week we light 1 candle and we focus on one of the 4 Advent themes. 2 weeks ago we lit the candle of hope. Last week we lit the candle of love. And this week our theme is joy, and Chris is going to light the candle of joy for us in just a moment. And then we'll have 2 candles left. We'll have the candle of peace, which we'll light next Sunday, and then the Christ candle we'll light during our Christmas Eve service, assuming we get to meet together, then we'll do it that night. So Chris is going to come now. He's going to light our Advent candle. He's also going to lead our scripture reading and our prayer for this morning. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. It's the third week of Advent, the week of joy. And this morning I'm going to light the pink candle after I read the scripture. Now today's scripture comes from Luke 2, verses 8 through 11, and it's a very familiar passage. It's one of the most common passages about the announcement of Christ's birth, which is definitely a reason to have joy. But you might also recognize it from Charlie Brown Christmas, when Charlie Brown exclaims, "What is the meaning of Christmas?" And Linus goes on to cite this passage. That's such a wonderful part of that play. So let me read the verses for you now. Luke 2, 8. In the same region, there were some shepherds staying out in the fields and keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord suddenly stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terribly frightened. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today in the city of David there has been born for you a Savior who is Christ the Lord." Now I encourage you to open your Bibles and read this passage to yourself or with your family. Read it on Christmas. It's definitely something that will bring joy to your heart.
Good morning, everyone. Today's scripture reading is from Psalm 30. It's a Thanksgiving Psalm of David, where he acknowledges God's deliverance and calls on the people to give praise to the Lord. Let's read it together and then pray. O Lord, my God, I cried to you for help, and you have healed me. O Lord, you have brought up my soul from Sheol. You restored me to the life from among those who go down to the pit. Sing praises to the Lord, O you his saints, and give thanks to his holy name. For his anger is but for a moment, and his favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may tarry for the night, but joy comes with the morning. Psalm 30, verses 2 through 5. Let's pray. Lord, in today's scripture, we see words like healed, restored, praises, and thanks, but we also see joy. And this joy comes through our relationship with you. In this passage, you healed and you restored, and all these good things come from you. It's our prayer as a congregation that those of us that are sick will be healed. This passage also speaks of restoration, and it's my prayer to be restored and refreshed through the reading of your word this morning. Lord, we can have joy, not because of our circumstances, because it is an uncertain time of COVID, but we can have joy that a vaccine's on the way. We can have joy that we have another day to serve you. Lord, I just ask that we all have peace and joy in our hearts, no matter what our situation is. Lord, we want to serve you here in Mandeville and wherever we are. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Please open your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 7. Isaiah chapter 7. This year for Advent, I'm preaching a series of sermons on messianic prophecy. Messianic prophecy. There are more than 300 messianic prophecies in the Old Testament, and Jesus fulfilled every single one. And in this series, we're looking at four of those messianic prophecies. First one was Ezekiel chapter 34, which was a prophecy about the coming of the true shepherd of Israel. Last week it was Psalm chapter 2, a messianic psalm that predicts the death and the resurrection and the ascension of Christ, and also predicts his eternal reign as king when he comes again. Today we're going to be looking at Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. Just one verse today, one verse. But that one verse is Isaiah's prophecy of the virgin birth of the Messiah, the virgin birth. We'll also be reading today from Matthew chapter 1, where we're going to see Isaiah's prophecy fulfilled when Christ is born in Bethlehem on the first Christmas. And then next week we're going to look at Micah chapter 5, where we find the prophecy that Bethlehem is going to be the place where Messiah is born. That's where we find that prophecy, and that's next week's sermon. But today, as I said, we're going to be looking at the virgin birth. And no, there's no other detail in the Christmas story that's more important than the virgin birth. It's one of the fundamental doctrines. It's one of the foundations of the Christian faith. If we deny the virgin birth, we're also denying the truth of God's word. We're denying the deity of Christ and the atonement of Christ as well. Besides that, it's not a big deal. Okay. But according to a study by Pew Research in 2017, the great majority of Christians, about 85%, believe in the virgin birth of Christ. That's not too bad, 85%. It should be 100%, but 85% is not too bad. But as you might imagine, it's a shrinking majority, because in 2014, it was 90% that believed it. So it's dropped 5% in just 3 years. There's also a generational gap. Only 69% of Generation X and only 55% of millennials believe in the virgin birth, which means that we're not doing a good enough job of teaching our kids about these things. And so I want to spend just a few minutes telling you why it's so important that we believe in the virgin birth. Why is it so important? It all goes back to the doctrine of substitutionary atonement. Substitutionary atonement. That's the idea that Jesus died on the cross as our substitute, and he atoned for or paid for our sins. Substitutionary atonement. Okay? And in order to be our substitute, Jesus had to be human. He had to be human. Because only a human being could pay the debt that was owed because of human sin. Only a human being could do that. But in order to be our substitute, he also had to be sinless, so that his death could pay for our sins. If Christ was a sinner, then his death could only have paid for his own sins, right? But there's a problem, because every human being since Adam and Eve has been born with a sinful nature. And so Christ couldn't be merely human, okay? He couldn't be merely human. He had to have a divine nature as well. And it's because of the virgin birth, that Christ is able to have two natures. He is man because he came through Mary's womb, and he is God because he was conceived by the Holy Spirit. And so he's fully human and he's also fully divine. He's both the Son of God and the Son of Man. And the point is that the virgin birth is necessary if we want to affirm that Christ has two natures. It's necessary if we want to do that. Let me try and explain that another way. Jesus had to have at least one human parent, or he could not have shared in our humanity. And if Jesus wasn't human, then as I said, he couldn't die as a substitute for human beings. But if both of his parents were human, then he can't be God, right? It's that simple. The bottom line is, if Christ is not born of a virgin, then he's just a man. He's just a man. His existence would begin at conception. He could not be the eternal God in human flesh. And if he's not God, then he's not sinless. And if he's not sinless, then we're not saved, right? Because if he's not sinless, then as I said, he couldn't die on the cross in our place and pay for our sins. And that's why the virgin birth is so important to our faith, okay? So I hope you know that. I hope you understand that. I hope that made sense to you. Look at Isaiah's prophecy of the virgin birth. In Isaiah chapter 7, the prophet speaks to Ahaz, the king of Judah, in the year is about 735 BC. And just to remind you, that's during the period when Israel was a divided kingdom. It was a divided kingdom back then. That's when the 10 northern tribes formed a northern kingdom called Israel, and the 2 southern tribes of Benjamin and Judah formed a southern kingdom called Judah. And as I said, Ahaz was the king of Judah. And so here's what was happening when Isaiah spoke to Ahaz in chapter 7. Rezin, the king of Syria, and Pekah, the king of Israel, had formed an alliance, and together those two kings were about to invade Judah. And King Ahaz and the people of Judah were afraid. And so God spoke to King Ahaz through the prophet Isaiah, and he said, "Don't be afraid, because the invasion is not going to succeed." And in verse 10, God offers Ahaz a sign to guarantee the truth of his word. But Ahaz won't ask for a sign because he doesn't want to test the Lord. Look at verse 10, Isaiah chapter 7, verse 10. Then the Lord spoke again to Ahaz, saying, "Ask a sign for yourself from the Lord your God. Make it deep as Sheol or high as heaven." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask, nor will I test the Lord." Then he said, "I listen now, O house of David." This is Isaiah speaking. "Listen now, O house of David. Is it too slight a thing for you to try the patience of men, that you will try the patience of my God as well? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son, and she will call his name Immanuel. He will eat curds and honey at the time he knows enough to refuse evil and choose good. For before the boy will know enough to refuse evil and choose good, the land whose 2 kings you dread will be forsaken." May God bless the reading of his word. So Ahaz won't ask for a sign. And Isaiah's reaction tells us that God is not pleased by that. You know, it's ironic that Ahaz doesn't want to test the Lord, because that's exactly what he ends up doing. He tests the Lord's patience in a very big way. And verse 14 says, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son, and she will call his name Immanuel." And that's our text for this morning. Okay, that's the prophecy of the virgin birth of the Messiah, Jesus Christ. And I have a 3-point outline based on that one verse, based on Isaiah 7:14. First, we have the message of Christmas. Second, we have the miracle of Christmas. And third, we have the meaning of Christmas. The message of Christmas, the miracle of Christmas, and the meaning of Christmas. That's my outline for today. So the message of Christmas is there in the first part of verse 14. It says, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign." At its very core, Christmas is a message from God to mankind, isn't it? On the first Christmas, God sent a message to man using a language that we can understand. He sent a message to us through the living Word, through the person of Jesus Christ. And the message of Christmas is, first of all, a message from heaven. It's a message from heaven. That's what we see in the Gospels, isn't it? Angels from heaven bringing God's message to earth. In Luke chapter 1, the angel Gabriel brings a message to Mary. She's going to have a baby. But it's not just any baby. Gabriel says he will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And then in Luke chapter 2, an angel of the Lord brings a message to some shepherds in the fields outside of Bethlehem. The angel brings good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today in the city of David has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And then in Matthew chapter 1, another angel of the Lord brings a message to Joseph in a dream, saying that Mary will bear a son, and you shall call him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. In the Christmas story, all of these angels come from heaven with a message that the one who made heaven and earth has left his throne in heaven and has come to earth. Okay, but the angels weren't the first ones to bring God's message from heaven, were they? They weren't the first ones to do that. Because centuries before, God sent the same message through his prophet Isaiah, when God gave a sign to Ahaz that would be fulfilled 700 years later in the birth, in the virgin birth of Christ. So the message of Christmas is a message from heaven, and it's also a message of hope. It's a message of hope. Because the child born of a virgin came to save us from our sins. He came to be born as a baby, to die on the cross, and to save the world. He came to bring glory to God and peace to men. It's a message of hope. And before Christ came, humanity was hopeless, weren't we? We had no hope back then. Since the fall of man in Genesis chapter 3, humanity has suffered from the disease of sin. The disease of sin. And in the Old Testament, it was a disease without a cure. You could sacrifice animals, and their blood offered a covering for sin, but not a cure. Not a cure. But on that first Christmas morning, God sent a message to man. He said, I've got a cure for your disease. My sinless son is going to come. He's going to be your sin bearer. He's going to take away all of your sins. The message of Christmas is a message of hope. It tells us that God has intervened on our behalf in the person of his son, Jesus Christ. Amen? And the virgin birth is God's Christmas message to the world. Okay, it's his message to us saying how much he loves us and how much he wants to be with us. It's the message of John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. God sent his son to be born on Christmas Day so that we could spend eternity with him, we could have eternal life with him. That's the message of Christmas. The miracle of Christmas is prophesied in the next part of verse 14, where it says, Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son. And Isaiah is actually referring to two sons and to two births in verse 14, two sons and two births. One was near in time, the other was 700 years away. And one was miraculous and the other was not. Okay? We're going to talk about the near in time, non-miraculous birth first. The prophecy in Isaiah chapter 7 actually had a historical meaning. It was a sign for King Ahaz, right? Near in time birth is not a true virgin birth. Okay, there's only been one true virgin birth in all of human history, and that's when Christ was born. The virgin in Isaiah chapter 7 is simply a young woman. She was a virgin at the time Isaiah spoke, and she would later marry and conceive in the normal way and bear a child. And that child's birth would be a sign for Ahaz that the invasion of Judah would fail. And before that child reached the age of accountability, in other words, before he knew enough to refuse evil and choose good, the two kings that Ahaz feared would come to nothing. That's what the Lord said to Ahaz through the prophet Isaiah. Okay, and we know that that prophecy was fulfilled, don't we? We know that child was born back in Isaiah's day. We don't know who it was. The Bible doesn't tell us who that child was. But we do know that the sign proved to be true. And that's because we know from Scripture and from history that all of the events that Isaiah prophesied ultimately came to pass. Okay? In 2 Kings chapter 16, it tells us that the kings of Syria and Israel failed to conquer Judah. They failed. Their invasion failed. And we know that Syria and Israel both fell to Assyria within the next 12 years. And so that's the immediate fulfillment. That's the near in time, non-miraculous birth of a child that Isaiah spoke about. So now turn with me to Matthew chapter 1. Let's read about the ultimate fulfillment of Isaiah's prophecy, the ultimate fulfillment in Matthew chapter 1. We're going to begin in verse 18. We're going to read about the miracle of Christmas, the virgin birth of Christ. Verse 18 of Matthew chapter 1. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child by the Holy Spirit. And Joseph, her husband, being a righteous man and not wanting to disgrace her, planned to send her away secretly. But when he had considered this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child who has been conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. And then Matthew says, now all this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet. And here's where he quotes from Isaiah 7:14. Behold, the virgin shall be with child and shall bear a son, and they shall call his name Immanuel, which translated means God with us. Okay? And so Matthew says that the birth of Jesus fulfilled Isaiah 7:14. We can take his word for it, can't we? We know that's true. But the question is how? How does that work? How is that a fulfillment of what Isaiah said back in Isaiah chapter 7? Well, this kind of prophecy is called a type, okay? A type is a prophetic symbol. A type is a person or thing in the Old Testament that symbolizes or foreshadows a person or thing in the New Testament. Let me say that again. A type is a person or thing in the Old Testament that symbolizes or foreshadows a person or thing in the New Testament. An example of a type is found in Exodus chapter 12. That's where the Passover lambs were sacrificed, to protect Israel from the plague of the firstborn in Egypt, right? And the killing of the lambs is a type because it foreshadows Christ's death on the cross. And here Matthew looks back to the book of Isaiah and he sees a type of Christ. He sees this sign given to Ahaz, the birth of a child to a young woman. He sees that as a foreshadowing of the birth of Jesus to a virgin named Mary 700 years later. So let's talk about that birth of Jesus. It says, behold, a virgin will be with child and shall bear a son. That's a miraculous statement, isn't it? That's a miraculous statement. You can't say that about anyone but Mary. And other than Jesus, nobody else in history has ever been born without a human father. And nobody else in history can say his mother was a virgin either, can they? From a purely human standpoint, it makes no sense. That's not how babies are made, are they? Even Mary had trouble with the idea when the angel first told her about it. In Luke chapter 1, verse 34, she says, how can this be since I'm a virgin? Right? We all know that it's impossible for a virgin to get pregnant, and Mary knew that too. She knew that too. But the angel told Mary, for nothing will be impossible with God. Nothing will be impossible with God. And the point is that the birth of Jesus was not simply a human event. It was a divine miracle. It was not a human event. It was a divine miracle. Christmas is a miracle. It reminds us that God can do the impossible, right? It's the miracle of the Creator becoming part of His creation. It's the miracle of the infinite becoming finite. It's the miracle of God becoming man. It's the miracle of God taking on human flesh. It's the miracle of God bypassing human ways in order to save humankind. And in this miraculous birth that's prophesied in Isaiah chapter 7 and fulfilled in Matthew chapter 1, we hear echoes of the promise of God all the way back in Genesis chapter 3 in the Garden of Eden, don't we? His promise that the seed of the woman and not of the man would bruise the serpent's head. Here's Charles Spurgeon quote for the week. He says, since the woman, by her venturous spirit, led the way in the sin that led to paradise lost, God in his wisdom ordained it so that the woman and the woman alone would usher in the one who regains paradise. I like that quote. Okay, and so the miracle of Christ's birth is prophesied starting in Genesis chapter 3 and going all the way through the Old Testament. And then the miracle takes place in the New Testament and it fulfills every single prophecy. And so that gives us confidence in two things, doesn't it? Number one, it gives us confidence in God's sovereignty, and number two, in His faithfulness. God's sovereignty and His faithfulness, amen? Because God is sovereign. He's sovereign over the big picture. He's sovereign over the small as well. He's sovereign over the events of world history. And He's sovereign over the details of individual lives. And He's also faithful. We know that God's word is true, don't we? So we can trust that all the prophecies about Christ's return will be fulfilled in the future, can't we? Just like all the prophecies about His birth were fulfilled in the past. So we've looked at the message of Christmas, we've looked at the miracle of Christmas. The meaning of Christmas comes in the last part of Isaiah 7:14. And she will call his name Immanuel. The meaning of Christmas is found in the name given to the virgin-born son. At Christmas, we celebrate Jesus, our Immanuel, right? The one who came to be God with us, our Immanuel. As I said before, there was a child born in the Old Testament back in Isaiah's day. We don't know who that child was. But that child's birth was a sign to Ahaz and to the people of Judah that God was with them, that he was still with them. It was a sign that God would not forsake them, but he would preserve them. And that Immanuel, born in the Old Testament, is a picture of the baby born in a manger in Bethlehem. The virgin birth of Christ is also a sign that God will not forsake his people. Instead, he will offer us salvation and eternal life in his Son. In the New Testament, Jesus Christ came to be Immanuel in a different way. He came to be God with us in the flesh. Here's another Spurgeon quote. Spurgeon says, Immanuel, God with us, in our nature, in our sorrow, in our punishment, in our grave, and now with us, or rather we with him, in his resurrection, in his ascension, in his triumph, and in his glory. Amen. When we think of the Christmas story, we think about the nativity scene, don't we? We think of the baby Jesus lying in the manger or being held by his mother. But the Christmas story is not just about the baby Jesus, okay? It's also about the person of Christ and what he was born to do. And so we cannot think of God coming to dwell with us without remembering that he also came to die for us. The baby in the manger would grow up to be the suffering Savior. Here's C.S. Lewis' quote for you. He says, in the Christmas story, God descends to reascend. He comes down, down from the heights of heaven, into time and space, down into humanity. But he goes down to come up again and bring the ruined world up with him, to bring the ruined world up with him. I like that. Do you know when and where the tradition of mistletoe began? The ancient Druids in Northern Europe believed that mistletoe had medicinal benefits. They even believed it could cure broken relationships. And so when two enemies found themselves under a tree with mistletoe in it, they saw that as a sign from God that they should lay down their weapons and be reconciled. And later, when Christian missionaries came to Northern Europe, they thought that mistletoe was a perfect symbol for what happened on the first Christmas when Christ was born. In other words, peace on earth, goodwill to men is a mistletoe message. It wasn't until much later that the mistletoe developed a more romantic connotation and people started kissing under it. And Paul gives us the mistletoe message in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We're going to read verse 19, beginning in verse 19. Here's Paul's mistletoe message. He says, namely, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and he has committed to us this word of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were making an appeal through us. We beg you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. He made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. I love that verse. In other words, Jesus was born so that he could die for our sins, so that we could receive his righteousness in return, so that we could be reconciled to God ultimately. The virgin birth is God's way of telling mankind that we don't have to be his enemies anymore. By the gift of his Son, we can be reconciled to him. And C.S. Lewis says, the Son of God became a man to enable men to become sons of God. Let me say that again. The Son of God became a man to enable men to become sons of God. That's the gospel, right? That's the meaning of Christmas. At Christmas, we celebrate the miracle of the virgin birth, the miracle of the incarnation, the miracle of God taking on human flesh so that he could be with us, so that he could one day go to the cross and die for us, so that ultimately we could be with him forever. That's God's Christmas gift to the world. That's his Christmas gift to you. And maybe you're watching this video and you've never opened, you've never received that gift. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9 says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. In other words, salvation comes as a free gift of God's grace. It's a gift. But like any gift, it has to be received. It has to be opened by you. And if you've never opened God's Christmas gift to you, his gift of salvation and eternal life, and I'm going to invite you to do that right now. I'm going to invite you to do that right now. You can bow your heads and close your eyes. We're going to pray together. I'm going to lead you in a prayer to receive Christ as your Savior this morning. If you want to do that, you can do that right now. But I'm going to tell you that you're not saved by praying a prayer. You're saved by faith alone in Christ alone. Okay, but if you want to tell God what's happening in your heart right now, you can speak to him in your own words. You can say something like this. You can say, dear God, I admit that I'm a sinner and I ask for your forgiveness. I believe that Jesus Christ is your Son. I believe that he died on the cross in my place and paid for my sins. And right here and right now, I'm trusting Jesus as my Savior. Thank you for loving me and for giving me eternal life. And for the rest of us, Father, we're so grateful for the Christmas gift of your Son. We thank you that he left his throne in heaven, Father, and came to earth and was born of a virgin. We thank you that he came, Father, in order to save us from our sins. We thank you that he knew everything that was going to happen. He knew everything that he had to do on this earth, and he came anyway, Father. We're so grateful. And Father, with everything going on around us in these days, we ask you to help us focus on the true meaning of Christmas. Help us to focus on and to celebrate the miracle of Christmas, the virgin birth of Christ. And help us to go out and share the message of Christmas, the message from heaven, the message of hope, the good news of great joy that's for all the people, Father. Help us to share that message with everyone we meet. Help us to share it with a world that needs hope. And in this Advent week of joy, Father, no matter what trials or tribulations we're dealing with or going through in our lives, help us to find joy in our relationship with you through Christ our Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now we're going to do our closing song. It's going to be Hark the Herald Angels Sing. And I talked about that last Christmas Eve. On our Christmas Eve service, I spoke about that song. I said that it was written by Charles Wesley, the great Methodist hymn writer. He wrote it in 1739, and its original title was simply A Hymn for Christmas Day. A Hymn for Christmas Day. But you may not know that the original opening line wasn't Hark the Herald Angels Sing. It wasn't Hark the Herald Angels Sing, Glory to the Newborn King. Originally it began, Hark how all the welkin ring, glory to the King of Kings. Welkin was an old English word for heaven. But in 1753, the first line was changed to the words that we sing today by George Whitefield, a famous English preacher. And aren't we glad he did, right? You may also not know that the tune we use for the song today wasn't written until 1840. It was written by Felix Mendelssohn, who was one of the great composers of the 19th century. But Mendelssohn didn't actually write the tune for Wesley's hymn. He actually wrote it for the 400th anniversary of Gutenberg's invention of the printing press. And so it wasn't until 1855 that a man named William Cummings took Mendelssohn's tune for the printing press and put it together with Wesley's lyrics as revised by Whitefield, and it finally became the song that we all know and love and sing today. And so it took four men and over 100 years to write this song, and aren't we glad it did? So let's sing now. Let's sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Thank you very much. We'll see you next week, hopefully. Bye-bye.
Jesus.